Hachette Audio presents The Obelisk Gate, The Broken Earth, Book 2. Written by N.K. Jemisin. Read by Robin Miles. Includes a Mac and PC compatible PDF of appendices. To those who have no choice but to prepare their children for the battlefield. 1. Nassun, on the rocks. No, I'm telling this wrong. After all, a person is herself and others. Relationships chisel the final shape of one's being. I am me and you. Damaya was herself and the family that rejected her, and the people of the fulcrum who chiseled her to a fine point. Syenite was Alabaster and Innan, and the people of poor lost Alia and Mayov. Now you are Terimo and the ash-strewn roads walkers and your dead children, and also the living one who remains, whom you will get back. That's not a spoiler. You are Essun, after all. You know this already, don't you? Nassun next, then. Nassun was just 8 years old when the world ends. There is no knowing what went through little Nasun's mind when she came home from her apprenticeship one afternoon to find her younger brother dead on the den floor and her father standing over the corpse. We can imagine what she thought, felt, did. We can speculate. But we will not know. Perhaps that is for the best. Here is what I know for certain. That apprenticeship I mentioned? Nassun was in training to become a lorist. The Stillness has an odd relationship with its self-appointed keepers of stone lore. There are records of lorists existing as far back as the long-rumored eggshell season. That's the one in which some sort of gaseous emission caused all children born in the Arctics for several years to have delicate bones that broke with a touch and bent as they grew. If they grew. Humanists and archaeomists have argued for centuries over whether this could have been caused by strontium or arsenic, and whether it should be counted as a season at all, given that it only affected a few hundred thousand weak, pallid little barbarians on the northern tundra. But that is when the peoples of the Arctics gained a reputation for weakness. About 25,000 years ago, according to the lorists themselves, which most people think is a blatant lie. In truth, lorists are an even older part of life in the Stillness. 25,000 years ago is simply when their role became distorted into near uselessness. They're still around, though they've forgotten how much they've forgotten. Somehow their order, if it can be called an order, survives despite the first through seventh universities disavowing their work as apocryphal, and probably inaccurate, and despite governments down all the ages undermining their knowledge with propaganda. And despite the seasons, of course. Once lorists came only from a race called Regwo, West Coasters, who had sallow reddish skin and naturally black lips, and who worshipped the preservation of history the way people in less bitter times worshipped gods. They used to chisel stone lore into mountainsides and tablets as high as the sky, so that all would see and know the wisdom needed to survive. Alas, in the Stillness, destroying mountains is as easy as an origin toddler's temper tantrum. Destroying a people takes only a bit more effort. So lorists are no longer Regwo, but most of them tint their lips black in the Regwo's memory. Not that they remember why anymore. Now it's just how one knows a lorist. By the lips, and by the stack of polymer tablets they carry, and by the shabby clothes they tend to wear, and by the fact that they usually do not have real comm names. They aren't commless, mind. In theory, they could return to their home comms in the event of a season, although by profession they tend to wander far enough to make returning impractical. In practice, many communities will take them in even during a season, because even the most stoic community wants entertainment during the long, cold nights. For this reason, most lorists train in the arts, music and comedy and such. They also act as teachers and caretakers of the young in times when no one else can be spared for such duty. And most importantly, they serve as a living reminder that others have survived worse through the ages. Every calm needs that. The lorist who has come to Turimo is named Renthree Lorist Stone. All lorists take the calm name Stone and the use name Lorist, it being one of the rarer use castes. She is mostly unimportant, but there is a reason you must know of her. She was once Renthree breeder Tentik, but that was before she fell in love with a lorist who visited Tentik and seduced the then young woman away from a boring life as a glassmith. Her life would have become slightly more interesting if a season had occurred before she left, for a breeder's responsibility in those times is clear. And perhaps that, too, is what spurred her away. Or maybe it was just the usual folly of young love. Hard to say. Renthree's lorist lover eventually left her on the outskirts of the equatorial city of Penfen with a broken heart and a head full of lore and a wallet full of chipped jades and cabochons and one shoe-print-stained lozenge of Mother of Pearl. Renthree spent the Mother of Pearl to commission her own set of tablets from a napper, used the jade chips to buy traveling supplies and to stay at an inn for the days it took the napper to finish, and bought many strong drinks at a tavern with the cabochons. Then, newly outfitted and with wounds patched, she set out on her own. Thus does the profession perpetuate itself. When Nassun appears at the waystation where she has set up shop, it's possible that Renthree thinks about her own apprenticeship. Not the seduction part. Obviously, Renthree likes older women, emphasis on women. The foolish dreamer part. The day previous, Renthree passed through Turimo, shopping at market stalls and smiling cheerfully through her black, daubed lips so as to advertise her presence in the area. She did not see Nassun on her way home from creche stop and stare in awe and sudden irrational hope. Nassun has skipped creche today to come and find her and to bring an offering. This is traditional, the offering, that is, and not teachers' daughters skipping creche. Two adults from town are already at the waystation, sitting on a bench to listen while Renthree talks, and Renthree's offering cup has already been filled with brightly colored shards faceted with the quartan's mark. Renthree blinks in surprise at the sight of Nassun, a gangly girl who has more leg than torso, more eyes than face, and very obviously too young to be out of creche so early when it isn't harvest season. Nassun stops on the threshold of the waystation, panting to catch her breath, which makes for a very dramatic entrance. The other two visitors turn to stare at her, Jija's normally quiet firstborn, and only their presence stops Nassun from blurting her intentions right then and there. Her mother has taught her to be very circumspect. Her mother will hear about her skipping creche. Nassun doesn't care. She swallows, however, and goes to Renthree immediately to hold out something, a dark chunk of rock, embedded in which can be seen a small, almost cubical diamond. Nassun doesn't have any money beyond her allowance, you see, and she'd already spent that on books and sweets when word came that a lorist was in town. But no one in Turimo knows that there's a potentially excellent diamond mine in the region. No one, that is, except Origins. And then only if they're looking. Nasun's the only one who's bothered in several thousand years. She knows she should not have found this diamond. Her mother has taught her not to display her orogeny, and not to use it outside of carefully prescribed practice sessions that they undertake in a nearby valley every few weeks. No one carries diamonds for currency because they can't be sharded for change easily, but they're still useful in industry, mining and the like. Nassun knows it has some value, but she has no inkling that the pretty rock she's just given to Renthri is worth a house or two. She's only 8. And Nassun is so excited when she sees Renthri's eyes widen at the sight of the glittering lump poking out of the black hunk of a rock that she stops caring that there are others present and blurts, "I want to be a lorist too." Nassun has no idea what a lorist really does, of course. She just knows that she wants very, very much to leave Tenrimo. More on this later. Renthri would be a fool to refuse the offering, and she doesn't. But she doesn't give Nassun an answer right away, partly because she thinks Nassun is cute and that her declaration is no different from any other child's momentary passion. She's right, to a degree.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.